Welcome. I'm Sebastian Mahfoud, and you're listening to WCAT Radio, the on-air wing of En Route Books and Media, bringing you the dulcet sounds of Catholic wisdom.
Good evening, and welcome to another edition of Mater et Magistra, a study of the truths of the Catholic faith as they have been revealed to us by God, ultimately in the person, in the life, in the words and in the deeds of Jesus Christ our Lord, who is the fullness of God's revelation of himself to humanity. My name is Jason Brunel. I will be your host for the remainder of the hour. And tonight's show is going to pick up where we left off last week. This is a kind of a back to basics. This show is a back-to-basics show where we are going to cover the most essential foundational arguments for God's existence and for the divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so this is going to be a show to refresh our minds with regard to the study of apologetics. Apologetics is the study of, or the process of coming to an understanding of why we believe what we believe as Catholic Christians, and why it is supremely rational to make an act of faith, why faith is not in any way, shape, or form contrary to human reason. In fact, belief in God is the most supremely logical conclusion that we can come to when we look at all of the superabundance of evidence that we have to look to. But before we begin this venture, let us begin with a prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Fill the tension within us with a holy relaxation. Replace the turbulence within us with a sacred calm. Replace the darkness within us with a loving day. Replace the night within us with your day. Replace the winter within us with your spring. Straighten our crookedness. Fill our emptiness. Dull the edge of our pride. Sharpen the edge of our humility. Light the fires of our love. Quench the flames of our lust. Help us to see ourselves that we might see you and be fortunate according to your holy word. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. Eternal Father, you have called us into existence from all eternity. You have elected us to be your adopted sons and daughters in Christ, your only begotten Son, to be co-heirs with Christ, we thank you, and we pray that you might send the Holy Spirit into our hearts, that he might adore and glorify and thank you with the inexpressible groanings that only he can properly speak to you. Fill our minds this evening as we study these truths of both the faith and of human reason, as we exercise the gifts, of intellect and will that you have given to us, that we might come to better understand your existence and the absolute necessity of your existence, and how our minds must, of necessity, come to the necessary conclusion of your true and necessary existence if we are to truly be thinking in accordance with right reason. And we ask that you might send that light that is your divine Son into our hearts, that he might illuminate the truths of the faith and help us to break free from the darkness that is the consequence of sin, the darkness of the darkening of the mind and the weakening of the will that is a consequence of the fall of man into sin. That, and may you also forgive us of all of our sins as we beg your mercy and your love. And may we be granted all the graces we need to forgive all of those persons who have hurt us in any way, to let go of any anger, any bitterness, so that we might allow the healing love of Jesus Christ to fully enter into our hearts and to purify all of those areas within us that need healing, all of those wounded areas within our hearts that need to be touched by you, Lord. And we ask all of this through the most powerful, never-failing intercession of Mary Immaculate, who is the true mediatrix of all graces, as we pray, Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, true Mother of God and our Mother, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Our Lady, Queen of Peace, pray for us. Our Lady, Seed of Wisdom, pray for us. Our Lady, Co-Redemptrix, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And tonight we are going to pick up where we left off. Last week we spoke extensively on the five ways of Aquinas, which are probably the most famous of the main ways, the arguments for God's existence. This evening, we're going to branch out. We talked about the two fundamental arguments. The five ways are reducible to two. Basically, they take two types of argument. The primary one that is used at least four times by Aquinas in the Summa Theologia, are the cosmological. The cosmological argument is an argument from the belief that things exist, and if things exist in the cosmos, and that's where it gets its name, if there is a cosmos, if things do in fact exist, they must have been brought into existence by something other than themselves. Things do not cause their own being. There could only be one being, one potential being, who would be the cause of its own existence, and that being would be God. And that is what we're trying to prove, that there is a God. But we're really trying to come up with the truth. Is there a God? Is there not a God? Well, we have marvelous arguments that, and it is the official teaching of the church, and it is the official teaching of the church that unaided human reason, that is to say, the human mind, using the natural, rational powers of logic and of deductive reasoning and inductive reasoning, and using logic, we can come to the conclusion that God must exist. It is not, so the church teaches that it is not necessary to have recourse to divine revelation, and we know that the two sources of divine revelation are sacred scripture and sacred tradition. And while God's existence is a truth contained in the sacred deposit of faith, and while scripture does teach us that God does in fact exist, and while God's existence is in fact a revealed truth of the faith, the church additionally confirms for us that even if we were left to our own devices and we had to rely strictly on human reasoning, that provided that we are pursuing the truth in all sincerity of heart, with no bias, it would be entirely possible to come to the conclusion of God's existence using sound logic and sound reasoning and argumentation. And that's exactly what we did last week. We showed how it is possible to come to an understanding that God must exist as the first cause of all other intermediary causes, which ultimately give rise to all of the things that are around us right now, not to mention, or I should say, ourselves included. And we talked about how when it comes to a cosmological argument, ultimately you have to ask the question, is it possible for there to be an infinite regress? And as we stated last week, an infinite regress is when, okay, say something, I'll take myself. I exist. My parents brought me into existence, and their parents brought them into existence, and so on and so forth. So now I can keep going back, and I can stretch back, and the question becomes, well, can we stretch back infinitely with no first cause itself uncaused, with every single thing being explained in the short run by the thing that immediately precedes it, but no ultimate explanation for the whole chain of things? Well, that's it. That's it right there. There cannot be an infinite regress for the reasons I just explained. If we had an infinite regress, let's just hypothetically say that there is let's hypothetically put ourselves in the scenario where we posit the existence of an infinite regress, where basically each individual thing can be explained in the short run by the thing that immediately precedes it, temporally, logically, what have you. And so we have an explanation for each individual thing, but ultimately, there's no ultimate explanation for the entire chain of things. And if that were the case, nothing would exist. Nothing would exist. And that's the problem, because things do exist. Look around you. Close your eyes. You exist as a thinking thing. That's the problem with the infinite regress. If we could, yes, the infinite regress allows us to provide an approximate, immediate explanation for each individual thing in the short run. The infinite regress does give us the ability to provide an immediate explanation, or an explanation up to a point. But an infinite regress, by definition, has no first cause, itself uncaused. And if we have no first cause, itself uncaused, which would be God, and that would be in this situation, that would be the only adequate definition of God, and we would be in a situation where, again, every you can look to any one of the many things that exist or were in existence at some point, and you can say, okay, well, I can see how this, you know, was brought into existence by the by, you know, this that immediately preceded it, and this other thing preceded that, and so on and so forth. And we have these short run explanations that work in the, like I said, in the short run. But ultimately, we have no ultimate explanation for the entire chain of things that exist. And if there's no ultimate explanation, then nothing whatsoever should exist at all. Nothing should exist, neither you nor I. And yet, that is not the case. You exist. You're listening to this podcast right now. You can hear my voice. And even if I'm wrong about something that I say, even if you are wrong about something that you're thinking, at least you exist as a thinking thing, as Descartes would say, cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. Even if I'm mistaken about what I'm thinking about, I still exist, at least, at the very least, as a thinking thing. So even if you're trapped in your solipsistic mind and you think that you can't get out of your mind and you're just and you espouse the philosophical the metaphysical concept of radical rationalism, and if you believe that there's no such thing as matter, and you espouse a Hegelian dialectical the world as a will and idea, just pure idealism. Even if you're a pure idealist in the sense of believing that spirit is the ultimate explanation for all things, metaphysically speaking, even if you espouse that, still you have to explain what caused these spiritual things. So we're not talking primarily, granted, I mean, as of course, as Catholic Christians, we believe in, and certainly the great Aristotle, who St. Thomas Aquinas did the church such a tremendous service in turning to Aristotle and reconciling that brilliant philosophical system that Aristotle provides with the Catholic theology of his day, which is the self-same theology of our day, because Jesus Christ, who is the person who is the object of our faith, we may have the truths of our faith, which are codified in creedal formulations, but ultimately it is a person that we place our faith in. Even though we are called, of course, to believe certain tenets of the faith as they are expressed in propositions, what have you, ultimately it is a person that we have faith in, and that person is Christ Jesus, who came and walked on the face of this earth some 2,000 years ago, and who taught us, basically he finished God the Father's divine revelation of himself to humanity in his words and in his deeds. So that is the cosmological argument. Then we talked about the other form of argument, which would be there are many ways of referring to these arguments. We can call it the teleological argument, which is a fancy word for the word teleological means, or teleology. It means goal-oriented. It simply means that something is, if I'm teleological, I'm goal-oriented. If something is teleological, it is goal-oriented. So that is the meaning of that word, teleology, goal-oriented. And There is the teleological argument for God's existence, or the argument from design. And this is the idea that if there is design, then there must be a designer. And it is true that there is, in fact, design throughout the universe. Therefore, there must exist a universal designer. That is very simply the teleological argument for God's existence. And people say, well, why do I have to agree that or believe that where there is design, there's a designer? Well, because we do it in practical everyday experience. Pretty much whenever we see an example or an instance of design, we will automatically come to the conclusion that there must exist a designer who gave rise to that design, who an intelligent mind who is behind that design. I think last week I said if you have someone once said if you put a million monkeys behind a million typewriters for a million years, eventually one of them might type out all of Hamlet. But basically, what are the chances of that occurring? What are the chances? Slim to none. To really, imagine dismantling your watch and just taking the whole. And imagine it's one of those automatic watches that doesn't run on batteries. It's you don't even need to wind the thing up. It's the mere motion of your arm is sufficient to basically keep this thing not only ticking but keeping perfect time. That's just absolutely incredible in terms of an actual mechanism that is not a computer. Never mind, or dismantling a computer, and just you can pick the watch or you can pick the computer, anything that basically needs to be held together in a very specific, in a very, very specific manner. Imagine taking all of those parts to a watch, throwing them up in the air. How many times would you have to throw all of those pieces up in the air for all of the pieces to fall in just the right way such that the watch would be perfectly back to its back to the way it was, or back to the way it should be, in order for it to work as a ticking watch? I can't imagine how many, even if you had five lifetimes to do this every 2 seconds of your entire life without taking any breaks for a bathroom or lunch or dinner or whatever, it would be impossible for us to get to the point. The idea that you would ever take a handful of parts, throw them up in the air, and have them land all together. Or how many times you go to a toy store, you buy a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle, which is a lot, far less complicated, far less complex than the human mind, or all of the numerous conditions that were necessary for life to come into existence on this planet, never mind in intelligent life, but just life itself. How many times would you have to imagine taking that whole that box of a 1,000-piece jigsaw puzzle? How many times would it take you throwing that box of pieces up in the air? How many times would it take for those pieces to come down and land in just the right order to assemble the puzzle perfectly? Well, these are the astronomical chances of, what strikes me as so fascinating is that there are individuals. I have a very good friend who. He's just a diehard atheist. He's a very good man. He's a very morally upright man. But he was an agnostic for a very long time, and not surprisingly, he made the leap to atheism. And so I've challenged him to pray the prayer of the skeptic, which is, Lord, God, if you exist, if you're out there, and if you want me to believe that you exist, I'm going to need some kind of sign, something absolutely clear that can only be from you to show me. Now, this is a real prayer, and it's a real experiment. And if you or someone you know is having a difficult time with belief in God, I genuinely offer this as a very real challenge, because God's love is so immense. If a person is sincere in making that, in offering up that request, and is genuinely open to God revealing himself to that person, God will do that. I mean, he sent his only begotten son to die on a cross for us. If he was willing to do that, I'm sure he's willing to send you a small sign that he exists. Something that would be maybe small to you or small to other people, but significant enough for you to know clearly that this was no joke. And God would do that because his love is everlasting. His love is everlasting. His love is so immense. God is love. God is love. Love is his very nature. It is his very nature to love. Those were the two, really, Thomas Aquinas takes those two forms of argument, the cosmological and the teleological, or the argument from design, that whenever you see design, typically there is a designer behind it. And there does, in fact, exist design throughout the universe. Therefore, there must exist a universal designer of the universe, a cosmological designer. And the cosmological argument, if things exist, if anything whatsoever exists, there must be a God. Because things would not exist if there were no God. Because God is the first cause himself uncaused by any other being. If God were not the first cause, if God were not his own first, the first cause of all existence, and if God did not bring himself into being, if God was not entirely self-sustaining, he wouldn't be God. And some other being would have brought him into existence, and he would be simply an intermediary being, and we wouldn't be speaking about that particular being. We'd be speaking about the God that is, in fact, the first cause of all other things. And that's what the cosmological argument proves and shows to be absolutely in accordance with right reason and absolutely necessary. There must exist a first cause, himself uncaused, who brings himself into existence from all eternity, who relies on nothing else in any way, shape, or form, who is the ultimate cause of himself, who is entirely self-generating, who is entirely self-supporting. This being is the, and moreover, in order to bring one's self into existence from all eternity, to have no beginning in time, to live, as it were, outside of the dimension, the four dimensions of space-time, and to be the cause of one's own existence, that really is the hallmark of what it is to be God. Or one of the, I should say, one of the many hallmarks of what it is to be God. To be the sum of all perfections is another hallmark of what it is to be God. And you have these arguments as well. I'd like to now move into another argument, and this one is called the ontological argument. And again, these words are, these arguments, or I should say the names of these arguments, come from these really great words in philosophy. If you've studied philosophy, you'll be very familiar with these terms. If you've not studied philosophy, you'll probably never have even heard of these terms, and you're probably scratching your head, what the heck is that? What the heck is he saying? What was that word? So again, the word I used for the very first argument, it's cosmological. It's spelled C-O-S, cause, C-O-S, I'll spell it out with you, C-O-S-M-O-L-O-G-I-C-A-L, cosmological. That means an argument that is based on the existence of the cosmos. If there is a cosmos, and there is, if things exist, and they do, then there must be a God who is the first cause of all things. If there is a cosmos, and there is, if things exist, and they do, then there must be a, and if things are in motion, and they are, then there must be a first prime mover who is himself unmoved by any other being. God is the primary mover, the prime mover, who sets everything else in motion. So this is another one of Aquinas' proofs, the argument from motion. The argument from the first cause. The first cause of things that exist. The argument from perfection. God is the sum of all perfections. We think of things, we compare them to each other, we have an idea of what it is to be the best, and we can compare various things that are similar in their essence, for instance, comparing apples to apples. We can look at three apples and say, well, this is an edible apple. But so apple A is edible, but it's got some pretty serious brown spots. And then the second apple is definitely better than the first apple. The first apple is good, but it's got some brown spots. And so this other apple, second apple, this is better. There are fewer brown spots. It doesn't look quite as old, has a better smell to it, and so it's better than the first good apple. It's better. And then you look at another third apple, and it puts the other two to shame because it's the best of all three. And so you've got good, better, and best. And these are gradations. And these gradations would not be possible were it not for an ultimate standard. And God really is the ultimate standard of everything, because God is really the sum of all perfections. And that's how we're able to even make these comparisons. So you have God as the ultimate standard of perfection. And then lastly, we have first cause of the God is the prime mover. First cause, it's himself uncaused. God is the standard bearer, the standard of all perfection. And God is the only being in the entire cosmos that must exist. That is to say, God is the only being whose existence is such that if he did not exist, nothing else would. Nothing else would. And that's the whole point of the cosmological argument, to show and to bear out the reality that God is indeed the cause of every single other thing that exists. And if there were no first cause itself uncaused, there could be no other existing thing whatsoever. There would be no universe, there would be no secondary causes, no intermediary causes, and ultimately there would be nothing in existence right now. Neither you nor I, nor this radio program, nor the internet, nor space, nor time, nothing. God, there has to be a first cause itself, uncaused, who is the ultimate explanation of all that is, without whom nothing could ever possibly exist. And so those are some really significant arguments. But there are more. There are plenty more. Those are two of the best. This next one is called the ontological. Ontological is it's a word. It's a ultimately philosophy. The word philosophy comes from the Greek, which breaks down to philo and sophy, philia, or to love. Basically, philo sophy is a lover, a philosopher is a lover of wisdom. To love wisdom, sophy is wisdom, and philia is love. And so a philosopher is a lover of wisdom. But within the discipline, the academic discipline of philosophy, you can break it down into, well, at least from a scholastic standpoint, the standpoint of Thomas Aquinas and the system that is used to train Roman Catholic priests. Every priest, before he goes on for his theological studies and his master's degree in theology, he will earn a bachelor's degree in philosophy. And if he already has a bachelor's degree, he'll just go for 2 years and just take all philosophy courses and have and earn what they call a BPhil, a Bachelor of Philosophy. And the reason for this is to provide the logical foundation, because theology is, I think we've talked about this at great length, there's a significant difference between theology, which is the study of God from both philosophy and theology study many of the same things: God, the human person, ethics, morality. There's great overlap. The difference between the two is that when studying from a theological vantage point, we assume or we presuppose the truth. We assume the truth of divine revelation. We assume the Bible to be the Word of God. We don't call the Bible into question. We assume that everything that the Bible contains it has been divinely revealed by God. And so the question of the question of the inerrancy of the Bible or the authority of the Bible, they can be dealt with from a theological vantage point, but when arguing I don't want to say a deeper level, but at a different level, at a more fundamental level. For instance, you can have someone who studies theology and have a person might have a really fantastic command of sacred scripture and could have a really amazing giftedness in terms of remembering sacred scripture, passages from sacred scripture, the stories, and theology and what have you. And that's fantastic when having a discussion with another individual who also agrees that sacred scripture is indeed inspired by God, inspired by the Holy Spirit, inerrant, which is to say that there is nothing whatsoever that is erroneous in this text. That this text is utterly inspired by God, and this is the word of God. This is the word of God, and that's great. So that's a two folks who both. So you can have a Catholic and say a Lutheran or a Baptist or any number of individuals who are of the more traditional Protestant backgrounds who would agree with the Catholic that the Bible is an inspired document. And that would, but if you're arguing with someone who is of a completely different faith, or someone who doesn't accept the authority of sacred scripture, then you're going to need to meet that person at a completely different place. And that's precisely where philosophy comes in. And that is precisely why every priest who goes through the process of being ordained to the priesthood in the process or throughout the process of that man's education, he will have to study philosophy before he even begins his theological studies. Granted, I'm sure he'll take a few, you know, basic courses in overall theology in his what they call pre-theology, which is usually a two-year program for folks who have a bachelor's degree or even a master's, but not in the fields that are necessary for the priesthood, which would be philosophy and or theology. So again, that person has to have that philosophical foundation to ask those deep questions. Well, okay, how do you even know that God exists? So, you know, those people who call into question the very existence of God, and this is where apologetics comes in. Apologetics is great when you're arguing with someone who is calling into question these really fundamental things that oftentimes it's easy to think, well, you know, this is, well, why should I have to prove that God exists? It's a given. Well, actually, no, it's not. Not these days. We live in a culture that is incredibly, incredibly secular, and that's no judgment of the culture. It is simply an observation and a statement of the facts. We live in a very, very secular, many have said post-Christian society. So basically, as a civilization, as a culture, as a Western civilization has tried Christianity and basically found it wanting. At least that is what has occurred in the last 100 years. We have seen, we watched Christianity fizzle into almost non-existence throughout the 20th century. And as we made our way into the 21st century, we're witnessing the reality that we are living in truly a post-Christian era. People are becoming, by and large, more and more hostile to Christianity. And if ever there was a time in human history to study apologetics, that time is now, my friends, because we have never faced so much opposition, so much bitter hatred. It's really an uncanny thing that we're witnessing. And I, for one, I mean, you can go ahead and call me a tinfoil hat conspiracy theorist. That's fine. But I really do believe that we are in the times that are spoken of in the book of Revelation. I truly believe it. I believe that many of the signs of the end times they aren't simply appearing. They're everywhere. I think one would have to be blind to not acknowledge that the signs of the end times are upon us. One of those signs, one of the biggest, will be a great apostasy. Apostasy is the widespread rejection of the faith that was once held, the truth. And that's exactly what we're witnessing. That's exactly what we've seen being chipped. We watched, I watched in my lifetime, and I'll be 45 in August. And I mean, that's a very short period of time, relatively speaking. And to witness the disintegration of, to watch the world's, one of the world's largest religions being persecuted to the point of being the single most persecuted of all religions in the world, to the point of extinction in many, many areas of the world, that's just, it's just unbelievable. And it's deeply, deeply saddening. But our Lord did state that these things must occur before his second coming. There would be a great, great, great apostasy. There would be a bloody, bloody, bloody persecution of Christians. We're witnessing that now. Christians are being slaughtered, entire Christian communities in the Middle East and in Africa are being slaughtered, beheaded, and it specifically speaks in Scripture of the beheading of Christians, and that is exactly what is taking place. That is the method of choice amongst the Islamic extremists who will give one the option of either converting to the faith of Muhammad, Islam, or of being put to death. It's one or the other. Either you die for Christ and become a martyr, or you forsake Christ and convert to Islam. And I sincerely pray that Our Lady will obtain for me the grace to lay down my life for the truth of our Lord's kingship and our Lord's lordship of the entire universe, that should the day ever come where I have to bear witness to the point of laying down my life, that the Lord would give me the grace to lay down my life bearing witness to the truth of his holy gospel, to shed every last ounce of my blood for the gospel. It's easy to say. It's very easy to say. But it's something I must pray for on a daily basis. And I think every one of us, every one of us Christians, we must pray for the grace to be willing to lay down our lives, to be willing to give up our very lives for the God who gave his life for us. What does it gain a man to profit a world? What does it gain a man to what does it profit a man to gain the world and to lose his soul in the process? This whole existence on earth, our whole existence on earth, is a preparation for our ultimate goal, which is eternity in heaven, with participating in the very divine triune life of God, so that through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we might offer an unceasing act of adoration and glorification and gratitude and expiation and supplication to the Eternal Father for all eternity, praising God with all the angels, all the saints, and the entire church triumphant in heaven, which is singing for all eternity, Sanctus, 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 holy, holy, holy are you, Lord God. That's the goal. That's the goal. So we need to be able to defend our faith and to provide and to be prepared, as Scripture tells us, be prepared to provide a reason for the hope that is within you as a Christian. We need to be ready to be able to defend our faith. And this is what that show is devoted to. Right now, we're moving on to the argument called the ontological argument. Now, essentially, the first individual we know of to develop this argument was the great Saint Anselm, and Saint Anselm began with a quotation from the Book of Psalms, where he states, "The fool says in his heart, there is no God; that God does not exist." That is how he begins, and from there, he explains that whenever we think of God, or basically he uses the word to conceive, whenever we conceive of God, whenever we think about God, even if we do not believe in his actual existence, simply thinking about him, to think of God is to, or to conceive of God, is to conceive of that which nothing greater than can be conceived of. So God is, by definition, you know, in philosophy, we have to be really, really clear with our terminology. We have to use clear terms and really clearly define our terms. So Anselm is defining the term God, and he is stating that God is that which nothing greater than can be conceived of. So God is that being which nothing greater than God can be conceived of. And I think I said Aquinas, but it's Saint Anselm. Saint Anselm is the author of the ontological argument. And so he says, if we conceive of God as that as being that being, God is that which nothing greater than can be conceived of. And if we conceive, so we can all agree that that is how we should or ought to conceive of God. Now, if we conceive of that which nothing greater than can be conceived of as not existing in reality, according to Saint Anselm, then we're not really conceiving of that which nothing greater than could be conceived of, because it is better, it is more perfect to exist in reality, metaphysically and ontologically, hence the name of the argument, than it is to simply exist in the mind as an idea. So Anselm is making the argument that it is solely in our ability to think of God. Basically, he's stating that because we can think of God, who is defined here as that which nothing greater than can be conceived of, because we can conceive of that which nothing greater than can be conceived of, we are necessarily conceiving of a God that exists in reality, ontologically, as opposed to a God who simply exists in the mind as an idea, since we cannot conceive of that which nothing greater than can be conceived of as simply an idea, because if we're not conceiving of God as an existing thing, then we're really not conceiving of God. Therefore, to conceive of God is a manifestation of his existence, is a proof, if you will, of his existence. Since we cannot conceive of God as not existing, and I think that's really how Anselm would boil it down. Since we cannot conceive of God as not existing, or since we cannot say the word God without basically, it's the idea that when we simply speak the word God, we are because we understand that the definition to say the term is to understand the definition, and part of that, an essential aspect of the definition of the term, of the name God, is that he exists in reality. It's because he's the greatest being. Nothing greater than God can be conceived of. And certainly it is far superior to exist ontologically than it is to simply exist in the mind as an idea. Now, some people have attacked this argument and said, well, that doesn't make any sense because I can conceive of the most perfect duck just because I can conceive of or the most perfect Caribbean island, that doesn't mean that it necessarily exists. Now, I've heard a lot of people actually say that and use that line of argumentation, but that is to use that line of argumentation is to completely miss the point of this argument, because God is the sole being that this argument will not work for any other being. It will only work for God, because only God is that which nothing greater than can be conceived of. Since we cannot conceive of God without conceiving of him as being actually in existence, I think a lot of people would argue with that. I don't think it's the best argument for God's existence. I think it's a really fascinating argument for God's existence. I think Anselm makes an illicit and implicit jump from thought to thing, and I think there is a problem. And to be fair, Thomas Aquinas rejects this idea. Thomas Aquinas disagrees with St. Anselm's argument that this somehow proves God's existence. If I'm not mistaken, I think I recall Thomas stating something to the effect of a thing can be I think Aquinas begins by making a distinction between things that are self-evident in themselves and things that are self-evident to us. And he would say, while it is true that the term, yes, it is self-evident that God's, you cannot conceive of God as not existing, and to conceive of a God as not existing in reality is not to conceive of the true God, and that's true, and there's a certain self-evidence in that, and so Aquinas concedes that much to St. Anselm. However, he makes that distinction. There are things that are self-evident in themselves and things that are self-evident, in themselves and to us, and things that are self-evident in themselves but not self-evident to us. And it is of the latter class that Aquinas categorizes the ontological argument, stating that it is self-evident in itself, however, it is not self-evident to us. Therefore, this does not work as a solid argument for God's existence, at least in terms of manifesting to the unbeliever how it would be that simply thinking about God would, you know, give, just because we can think of God and because we can have an idea of God, must necessarily give rise to, must prove, therefore, the reality of that God. So that's again an interesting one, but it's almost time for the show to come to a close. Before we do, I'd like to briefly just touch on one last argument called Pascal's wager. And this is a really fun argument because essentially Pascal, I'm sure many of you have heard of Blaise Pascal, the brilliant mathematician. In addition to being the brilliant mathematician, he was a brilliant philosopher, and like Descartes, Blaise Pascal came up with, he did not think that it was possible to prove God's existence, even logically. So he disagreed with the church on that point. However, he did believe that belief in God and living a life in accordance with that belief system is the best bet that you can make when it comes to, if you had to bet on whether or not God existed, and if you had to live accordingly, that the best possible bet that you could make would be to believe in God's existence and to live a life in accordance with that belief. And why would that be the best bet? Well, ultimately, either there is an afterlife or there's not an afterlife. If there is not, well, let's start with the not. If there's not an afterlife, I'm going to start that over again. We've got Pascal, we've got the whole wager, okay? And we have two choices. We can choose to believe that there is an afterlife, believe that there is an afterlife. Or we can choose to not believe. So those are our two options. We can choose to believe that there is an afterlife, or we can choose to not believe that there is an afterlife and live accordingly. Now, if we choose to believe that there is, yes. So we're saying, yes, there is a heaven and a hell. If we choose to believe and there is not an afterlife, so if we say, yes, I believe, and there's no afterlife, then we've really lost nothing. If we believe that there is an afterlife and we live accordingly, and there is an afterlife, then we hit the jackpot. So basically choosing to believe and having it turn out that there is an afterlife where one is rewarded and or punished based on how one lived and how one believed, you can believe or not. Now, if we do not believe that there's an afterlife, and it turns out that there is no afterlife, we've lost nothing. But if we choose to not believe and it turns out that there is an afterlife, well, then we're in hot water. Then we're in hot water. So if you look at all the four possible outcomes, clearly the best of them is to believe that there is an afterlife just in case there is. And that is the best bet. So that is what we call Pascal's wager. Ultimately, it's up to you whether you believe or not, and whether or not you live accordingly. But the best bet to ensure a happy, long life for oneself, to ensure that, one must believe and fashion one's life according to those beliefs, and basically subject one's will to the divine will. And really, people will find, granted, I wouldn't base my entire belief system on a bet. I don't think that's a good place to begin. But it's one of many, I think, very interesting thought experiments. And that's really what all of these are. They're thought experiments that provide us with evidence for coming to a logical conclusion about this very, very crucial, critical issue. And it's not something at all to be taken lightly. This is our eternal salvation depends on this question. And it amazes me, the number of people and how the mass media so trivializes this issue in their effort to, but actually it shouldn't surprise me, because it is often said that the devil's most effective and greatest accomplishment was getting people to believe that he doesn't exist. And I think really there's a tremendous truth in that. It is very powerful to be the only person in a room full of people who believes in God, especially when you go off to school, to an academic setting where there is, you have professors, many of whom are self-proclaimed atheists, and these are, you know, supposedly the, you know, the best and the brightest. Well, if they're atheists, I mean, shouldn't I take them seriously? And that's, it took me some time to realize that just because someone has earned academic credentials does not mean that they know everything, nor does it mean that they're going to be correct about something that they really have that they themselves have not studied to any real extent. You may have, it's funny because a doctoral degree is really an incredibly specialized degree. We start off in higher education assuming that a person coming into a four-year university has the equivalent of a high school education. And just in case there were some gaps, we try to fill as many of them in by providing, so you make a fundamental decision between the arts, between going, basically it's the first major decision you make in college. Are you going to be an arts person or a sciences person? Are you going to pursue a bachelor, a BA or a BS? And so it goes from being very, very general, and you take a number of different courses and so part of that is to fill in the gaps, as it were, but it's also to expose you further to help you to make a decision as to what it is that you would like to do for the rest of your life, to expose you to a number of different disciplines that you may not have had the opportunity to study in high school, and to give you a taste of many different things that you could potentially major in. So you make a very basic, very broad distinction. And then ultimately, after your second year of college, you kind of have to declare a major. And that's a big deal because that's when you have to decide, okay, this is the field of study that I'm going to be, you know, getting into. And once that decision is made, you graduate with your degree in whatever field it is. And you probably, these days, you really can't do much with a four-year degree. You really have to go on for a professional degree, a master's at least, in something specializing in a certain area within the greater discipline that you got your bachelor's in. And then as you go, if you should choose to go on to further your education, and if you have the ability to study well and to retain information and to think things through thoroughly, you might be so gifted that you are offered scholarships to continue on in school and to advance and earn a doctoral degree, in which case you are staying with, you're not learning more in terms of going outside your field. In fact, you're doing just the opposite. You're specializing. You become a very highly specialized individual in a very highly specific area, and so a doctorate is when you have written a dissertation on a very, very particular aspect of of a part of a major discipline. So it's highly, 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 highly specialized. But I think the general public really doesn't understand that. And so having doctor before one's name, certainly any person who's been through any program that is fully accredited by the various accrediting boards, who has earned a PhD in any field of study, should absolutely be respected tremendously, because that is an incredible accomplishment, regardless of the field. It's an amazing accomplishment. But I think people don't understand that it's education becomes more highly specialized as opposed to more generalized. It's not as though we do broaden our understanding, and certainly someone, of course, it goes without saying that someone who earns a doctoral degree will have a very extensive knowledge, but it's in a very specific area. So anyway, that concludes our show for this evening. I thank you for listening, and I ask our Lord to bless us all. May the Lord bless us, protect us from all evil, and bring us to life everlasting. Amen. Thank you, and God bless.
We hope you enjoyed the program and will join us back for another show on WCAT Radio. This is Sebastian Mahfood. Good day.